Okay, the regular council meeting Monday, August the 3rd, 2000 PM, 2015 at 7 PM, about to come to order. Do we have a roll call, please, Mr. Collier?
Mayor McLaughlin?
Here.
Mr. McIntyre?
Here.
Mr. Zambach?
Present.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Kraybacher? Mr. Mike Lowry?
Here.
All present.
I want to thank everybody for being here. If you have a cell phone, if you wouldn't mind, please turning it off so we don't interrupt the meeting, if you would, or put on vibrate. And thank you for being here. We're going to now have the invocation by Councilman John Kraybacher. Please stand.
I want everybody to know that this is a prayer that Thomas Jefferson said on March 4th, 1801. To Almighty God, who has given us this great land for our heritage, we humbly beseech thee that we may always prove ourselves a people mindful of thy favor and glad to do thy will. Bless our land with honorable ministry, sound learning, and pure manners. Save us from violence, discord, and confusion, from pride and arrogance, and from every evil way. Defend our liberties and fashion into our one united people, a multitude brought hither out of many kindreds and tongues. Endow with thy spirit of wisdom, those whom in thy name we entrust the authority of government, they may be justice and peace at home, and that through obedience to thy law, we may show forth thy praise among the nations of the earth. In time of prosperity, fill our hearts with thankfulness, and in the day of trouble, suffer not our trust in thee to fail. All of which we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. So join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. We'll use the flag in the back, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay, may I have action on the minutes of the regular meeting on July 20th, 2015, please?
Second.
Mr. Kraybacher, I'm sorry. Yeah, Mr. Zambach, Mr. Kraybacher.
Motion by Mr. Zambach.
Zambach, Mr. Kraybacher, second.
Any discussion on this?
Any discussion, anyone, on the minutes?
Okay, Mr. Thank Mike you. Lowry?
Yes.
Mayor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Zambach?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Kraybacher?
Yes.
Passed 7-0.
Thank you. Yes, sir. I must not have heard. Communication, none tonight. City manager's report, if you would, please.
Thank you, Mayor, Council, members of the public. Randy is under the weather and asked me this morning to step in and run the meeting today. So I'd like to jump down. We have no reports currently, so I'd like to jump down to letter G, informational items. First one is, so we have a thank you letter that is attached. And I will read that out.
Mr. Kitko, if you wanted to, you could just read.
They're all here.
Mr. Kitko?
Yes.
If you wanted, you could just read the A, B, and C right off of here if you'd like. Expedite things.
Okay. Yeah, thank you letters attached are for Ledford Electric for fixing the lighting at Hensley Park sign. Item B is Mr. Bill Morrow for assisting Mayor McLaughlin in power washing the limestone columns and nearby sidewalk at Smith Park. These fine gentlemen also cleaned the Smith Park sign, which I think is still in the works to be repainted. The Hensley family and Fat Metals for lending the power washer for that event. Item number two, media requests for information, they are attached. New Carlisle News in regards to bidding process for Prentice Drive reconstruction. And item B, New Carlisle News requesting the fire investigation report. Item number three, Moorefield Township Police Cruiser Inspection. There is an email attached. Dave Coleman, our mechanic, and myself went up to Moorefield Township, met with one of the trustees and the current deputy that is operating that vehicle. After taking a look at it, they've had all their major maintenance service by a local dealership who also services the OSP's 19 Chargers. It looks in immaculate shape. No knocks, any kind of funny noises out of it currently when we test drove it. So that email's there, and I'm sure that Randy will probably be seeking some council input to go ahead and if we're going to continue to make that purchase on that cruiser or not.
Are we allowed to have questions right now, Mr. Mayor?
Question.
Pardon? I have a question about
Surely,
the police
go ahead.
Cruiser. Have we looked into the Bethel Township cruiser by any chance? It was brought up to us. It was cheaper, had less miles.
The Bethel Township that. Cruiser has 100 and some thousand miles on it. The Moorefield Township had 81, I think.
Okay, and vice versa. It was cheaper, not with
oh,
that's right.
Yeah, I think the cruiser was a little bit less than cost, but I think it's a little older. Okay. But I'm not sure. I'd have to go back. I don't know for sure.
Something I don't know if we had looked into it yet. So.
I have not.
Are you requesting that they take a look at that?
I think
office?
We should. I think we should look at all options.
I think that would be a good idea. I agree with you. Just to see. We could, Mr. Kitko, if you have find the two of you, maybe could take a quick look at that and see if, compare the two and see what you think. We're always definitely wanting to save money, that's for sure, if we can.
Okay. We'll definitely take a look at that. The next item, Wright-Patterson Air Force Base installation guide ad. We had put an ad in your packet that was, in 2014, and they had called us up and asked us if we would like to put our ad in to show New Carlisle is a place to go, just putting our name out there. I'm not sure, he just says it's attached. So I'm not sure if he's just looking for some comment from council on whether, after he gets with Colleen on budget stuff, to see if we can fit that in, and if it's something that council would like to see happen.
Questions on that, council? I do. Yes, sir. Go ahead, Mr. Kirk.
I need to ask who designed this.
Who designed the?
Yeah, the name design.
Oh, yeah, that's from Wright Pat Designs. Their whole it's when someone moves to this base from it does a duty station. That this is their book. They just put our thing.
To me,
it.
That wouldn't be impressive. You know, for somebody. I come look at the car.
I thought
wouldn't be would
it? Who would not?
I personally would like to see something a little more. If we're going to pay that kind of money, put an ad in there. I would like to see something more informative about New Carlisle. I mean, it says celebrating 200 years of growth and progress. Well, that's really true, but it would be nice if we had it. It's a great place to live. Some of the amenities that we have, I mean, that's a pretty good size ad. Seems like you can get more copy in there, do you think?
I will
I think it'd be worthwhile looking at it.
Yeah, I'll pass that on and see how it compares to maybe other municipalities or agencies sure. with that similar.
Yeah, it'd be a good idea to check it. Agreed, Mr. Kraybacher, is that what you had in mind?
Bear with me a second. Okay, down to item number five, Twin Creeks Sheriff's Sale. There, you have a notice attached. I think it's on the final page of your packet for all but one of the Twin Creeks parcels on August 28th, 2015. And then again, it will be happening September 11th. That's not in your packet, but that will be the second one. It's required to go through the Sheriff's Sale twice. Any questions on that?
Council, any questions? I'm sorry, we have one, please. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
I know Randy's not here, but could you explain why we're going to do this again? Because somebody went through the sheriff's
sale. The additional sheriff's sale is because of some of the lots did not go through a, I guess, at a level 10 title clearance as compared to maybe going through a level five. So it was requested that it go through a complete, all the way up to the state auditor for a clean title. And so then the ones that were in our name were taken back out of our name, went through this process again, and now they've went through the best route that a title would need to go through, from my understanding.
From my understanding, it was the buyer that requested that, the one that we had, that hopefully will still be on board. And that was the situation that he wanted. His attorney said that it that needed to happen for a better title. For him. Yes, I'm sorry. We have one.
You said all but one parcel. Is that the one that was already sold?
I'm not sure. I thought there was 30. Let me go back here in the pages. I'm kind of shooting from the hip here a little bit.
We did sell them. I believe that's what we did.
I think there were 28 when I saw them.
There was, I think, two sold. Yeah, two sold, and one has resold since then. On this sheet, it doesn't list how many, but I'm sure I'll put a note to have Randy maybe follow up with an email just stating the number.
I know they've had the ad in the paper, the Springfield paper, at least three times, I believe, which I'm sure required to do that. Any other questions?
And we'll move on to item number six, Hensley Park beautification. It was requested that we try and take care of the weeds in the parking lot, and then we had purchased about 20 ton of crushed gravel to get that parking lot looking a lot better with that we did, and then the company that is doing the mowing and a little bit of the flower bed cleaning that makes a good presentation or an entrance to our city. Right. We got that completed this past week.
They did a great job on that, by the way. It looks terrific.
All right, thank
once
you.
They finish, hopefully nobody's over there doing donuts and they're missing water. So.
I hope not.
And they rolled it everywhere.
And the City of New Carlisle would like to welcome a new employee to the office under Ms. Harris, Amy Garman. She's our new assistant income tax finance administrator. Just like to welcome her.
Thank you.
And item number, I added an eight that was not in your packet. It's a Board of Zoning Appeals BZA hearing, August 13th at 6 p.m. Fire station, and this is in regards to sign variances for a new auto zone. And that, Mayor, is all I have. I can entertain any questions on those, sure. Or if there's anything from council.
Council, yes. Let's go with Mr. Reynolds first.
Mr. Kiko, have you looked into the yard signs on Linden and Scott by any chance that were put in the access alleyway?
Yes, we did. Actually, the sign is on the edge of the right-of-way in line with the other telephone poles.
Okay.
So there's the clear 12-foot of access that was normally there. And I'm hoping that most of these people, when I drove by the last week, the grass was clean, it's cut. You can't tell people been driving on it. I just hope people don't drive on it like a asphalt alley.
Oh, okay. Yeah. And my next question is on Edgebrook. There's a huge hole next to one of the sewer grates, I know, and it's been that way for months, and there's just a barrel sitting out there. I know if what was being done to correct
Yeah, we
that.
Have a list in our street department of catch basins and dry wells that we have to get caught up on. So yeah, it's definitely on. If you see a barrel, we got it on our list.
All right.
But we'll double check, though.
All right. Thank you.
Anyone else? Questions? Mr. McIntyre?
I have one. It's sort of for the city manager, but Howie, you can pass along the message. I let Randy know about it. It's also for council, too, and the sergeant. It's about the police cruiser cameras and body cameras. As everyone knows, there's been a number of incidents that have happened over the last few months. It's really highlighted the need for the use of body cameras and also the cruiser cameras to help out our law enforcement. I don't have the numbers in front of me, but I know that it's something like the number of reports of police misconduct go down because once you have these, because you have it on record that this is what happened and here's how it played out, and also this can be used as evidence in court. And one of the things that we've been talking about for a while, and Mr. Lowry, I know you have brought this up too, is the need for our deputies to have equipment like the cruiser cameras and the body cameras. I think we're at a point now that we're healthy enough with our police department that maybe we can start looking at something like this. Obviously, we're going to be looking at grants and other things, but maybe start entertaining the idea of looking for cruiser cams and body cams, because right now I don't believe our deputies have any. I sent a few emails out to our state representatives and our federal representatives to ask them if there are going to be any mandates saying that we have to have them, that police departments have to have them. The New Sun had a story last week about their usefulness, and a few people in the Ohio legislature were sort of toying with the idea of making it mandatory. Right now, it doesn't look like there's anything coming down the road. Who knows if it'll happen, but I'd hate to be in a situation where, you know, we want to get something with these components to it, but then they pass a law saying it has to have that components to it. But regardless of that, I thought it would be a good idea if maybe we could look at it, look at some prices. Maybe the city manager could work with the sergeant on them, on what the sheriff's department uses, and maybe come up with some different options. We don't have to, right now, decide on anything, but just to get a little bit of the idea. And Sergeant, I was wondering if you could comment on how useful these cameras are, both the body ones and the cruiser ones, to help your deputies make sure they stay safe and do their job.
They're almost essential. What you don't know, because it came about rather fast, and Howie and I have talked about it on and off for a couple of months now, is the sheriff's office is going to provide body cameras for any deputy in Clark County. And those cameras are professional cameras. The one I have on now, this one, cost $150 in the last 30 minutes, but it's better than nothing. We're hoping to have all of them in service by the end of next month, the new cameras, which will record a whole day. They're writing a policy and procedure on it, and we are gonna need a little work done up at the substation. The only cost to New Carlisle would be providing the wiring into the building, and once the wiring gets to the building, and there's a firm going to come in and set up a computer. So when a deputy gets within so many feet, that information is automatically dumped into the computer. Now, all of that's public record, and the sheriff's office is also going to maintain that for you, which is huge. So this public information, we'll be able to have access to it, and that's a great benefit for us. That saves thousands and thousands of dollars. But there's going to be a small startup cost for New Carlisle. We're going to need a new server, which is about $100, and we're looking at around $400 for a stand to put the new computer in, which the sheriff's office is giving us the computer also. As far as car cameras, well, they've proven themselves over and over and over again. The sheriff's office has once again purchased car cameras for the deputies in the county, but not for New Carlisle. It will be a part of this system, so if a deputy drives by the New Carlisle substation, all the information that is already stored on their drive will automatically download to the New Carlisle substation, and it will be fed into the main station. At least that's the way I understand it. But New Carlisle would have to purchase those cameras, and they're roughly $5,200 a piece. And it is expensive, but it's absolutely necessary anymore. You no longer have to take our word for it. It's right there in front of it. So it provides protection not only for us, but for all the citizens. Answers any questions that people might have. They're not 100. Any camera or video is not 100% accurate, because there's different angles and views, and you've seen that in your baseball games and basketball games. But it is as close as we're going to get for right now. It does give very detailed information.
Well, and thank you. That's great news that the body cameras are coming about. So I guess right now the focus for us would be looking at the cruiser cameras then.
When we were up looking at the Moorfield car, initially it wasn't going to come with it, but the car camera is going to come with the car. But I don't know that it is up to date on what the new systems coming in will be. So if we purchase that cruiser, it will be in there. And then it still may need to be updated if they go to a whole new system. But I do know there is one currently in there that we saw that's coming with it if we get it.
That's great news. Thank you.
Finished? Anyone else? Yes, go ahead, Mr. Lyman.
How many do we need now? Because I know some of the deputies get out of the car, go home when somebody else gets in, so, I mean, you know, how many do we need?
Just initially, I think it's going to be three.
Okay.
We have, I think right now, currently we have two main cars, and then there'll be a third car that would be running, but you can't move the cameras that quick, because there is so much wiring.
Yes, Mr. Craver.
I was listening to Sheriff Kelly on Channel 2 today. He was there for the night out. Do you want to say something about that? And he said something about training, that they had special training downtown Springfield.
I know the sheriff is working a national night out, which is tomorrow night. Enid is having a huge event. I think the paper said there would be like 10 agencies, law enforcement agencies in Enid. I know we're having a committee up here for National Night Out, and I've got you some supplies. And I'm honestly not sure what his plans are for up here tomorrow. I can find out tomorrow, let you know as soon as possible.
Oh, it's okay. What about the training? That sounds pretty interesting. You know, it was, I forget what he called it. He said it was a mobile unit that went around, and the deputies had to have this training. So, you know what I'm talking about?
I'm not sure, but I have all the emails right here, and when you conduct your meeting, I'll look for it.
Yeah, well, he said his was that he thought that somebody was going after a gun, but really it was a child. You know, it was a different scenario. Said very likely, you know, he could have pulled on it, but he had to hesitate. You know.
I'll let you know here in just a few minutes.
Okay. I just thought it was funny.
Okay, anyone else, please? Mr. Kiko, back to you.
That is it.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. All right, we're now at comments from members of the public. Please limit comments to 5 minutes or less. Do we have somebody that would like to go up the podium, introduce themselves, their address? Please do.
All right, my name is Doug Pearson. I've been a firefighter for 30 years. I'm one of the ones that hold timers. And I'm really concerned about the department. You guys keep talking about us old timers that don't want to change. We want to change, but this is not the way we want it. I mean, we had a run over on Villa Saturday, I believe it was. You had two people showed up on that fire run and one officer. There was a guy in there that was bedridden. One of our assistant ex-chiefs got him out of that house, put the fire out. Where was the fire? Where was all the officers? Any answers?
I don't know the answer to that.
Well, I know, but you guys are so hip and hop over Brad. What are you going to do if there's a structure fire and somebody dies? Is that going to open your eyes a little bit?
So are you saying it's a safety feature?
Yes, it is.
Now that we have a safety feature again.
Is it going to take somebody to die or get hurt bad?
God forbid, no.
Okay, all your officers, most of them, live far away. They are made positions up so they can live far away because you're supposed to be within 5 miles of the city. What good are they? Okay, let me respond for 45 minutes away. Oh, the house is already burnt down.
See, the reports we get are saying that it's 4 point something, that the response time were 5 minutes. I can't remember offhand the last one we had.
4.7.
Is that correct? Am I correct?
4.7 was the last.
So this council is going by the reports that we're receiving and so forth.
Well,
now we understand, we want to hear from you. We want to know what's going on. Yeah. We had quoted an investigation to try and put this to bed.
It's not going to go to bed. I don't know why you guys keep saying this is not going away.
Well,
that was not an investigation. We all know that.
We don't know that.
Well, that's because you don't want to know that.
No, that's not true.
That is true.
That's not true.
Another thing.
We want to know that the citizens of this community are safe.
How can they be safe?
From the EMS and the fire.
How can they be safe when the officers are 45 minutes away or a half hour away?
I could agree with that. I don't think it's supposed to be set up that way.
You're right. But that needs to change.
You understand? You had the question? Go ahead.
Yeah, Doug, thanks for coming. I appreciate it. What's the answer? Because I keep hearing a lot of we're short, and I don't mean that sarcastically, that we're short on volunteers.
Yeah, right? We are. There is a page out every day. We need somebody to work these hours. Every day. I got it on my phone if you'd like to see it. But we got enough people, right?
Again, that's what we're hearing, yes.
But my question is,
really? Then why is it out there every day?
But my question was, is how do you get the volunteers in? I mean, you can't force it. And like I said, I'm not being sarcastic. I'm just asking. If you want people local in New Carlisle to be on the department,
you got to have somebody in charge of it. You got to put the word out that you need volunteers in this city. And I'll tell you what, the volunteers in this city are dwindling down fast. You guys may not realize this, but it is. The officers are dwindling down fast.
What's the approach to doing so?
What's the approach?
Yeah, what's the approach?
Is to get the officers in the city.
No, but I mean, what's the approach to getting the word out that we need volunteers from the city?
Paper, sign in front of the firehouse, volunteers wanted. You got to take steps to do this. And it hasn't been done yet. I'm supposed to be in charge of the hiring. I'm on light duty. They won't let me work firehouse on light duty. I hurt myself on a fire run. I got to have surgery. But I don't know.
Why is there not a sign around the city or a sign in front of the fire?
You'd have to ask him.
The one thing I've seen, it was on Facebook, that we supposedly were looking for people at that point.
Right.
Is that the only thing that's been put out? Do you know that?
I haven't seen it.
I saw that post.
Yeah, I saw a post on Facebook.
That's fine. Yes.
Mr. Lauer has a question for you.
How many volunteers are on fire?
Shit. How many's on there or how many shows up?
How many are on there?
There's probably about 7, 8.
There's only 7 or 8 volunteers?
Volunteers, that's in the city. Or maybe 10.
Total volunteers for the fire department.
But they all don't show up.
Pardon?
They don't all show up.
Boy, that's not the question. Okay, how many volunteers are on the fire department assigned to the New Carlisle fire department?
There's probably about 10 volunteers.
That's all?
Yeah, in the city.
Because in our report there was what, 42?
No. That's not volunteers. That's volunteers, but that's after we talked in. It's
what?
Part-time program. They don't live in this city.
Okay, say it again. There were 2 people talking. I didn't hear you. I'm sorry.
That's a part-time program.
Okay.
From other cities.
So you're saying that people you have assigned that are assigned to the fire department, the majority of them are not showing up?
A lot of times they're not.
The majority are not showing up?
Well, that's the way I see it. I mean, what about Saturday? How many showed up?
I guess my question would be that. Why are they still in the fire department if they don't show up?
Why? Are they?
Yeah.
He's not here to ask him.
I will ask that question.
You know, and...
You will.
Another thing.
Then Mr. Reynolds has a question.
I'm sorry, guys.
How many volunteers have stopped showing up since Mr. Phillips has taken over as chief?
Well, there's probably been, I know, at least 5 or 6.
And
I don't know if it had to do with chief or not. I mean, we don't have enough volunteers.
Doug, what's your title with the fire department?
I'm a captain, so far. I'll probably be getting picked down after this. Oh, well.
I want to thank you for your service, for coming here and talking to us, first of all. You said you were in charge, and I kind of got in charge of training or development or something thereabouts. Or you work with that?
Hiring.
You work with hiring.
Well, I read on the thing they sent me saying that I was supposed to be in charge of that, and I'm on light duty.
Because I have an idea, because there's obviously a need if we're having a shortage of volunteers and volunteers that we have now, not all of them are reliable, whatever it may be. Maybe we could sit down with the chief with the city manager and say, hey, let's think of a great sort of a PR campaign, some way to try to get the message out, whether that be getting signs on the fire department, getting something in a newspaper, getting something on the internet, whatever it be. If we need more people because every day they're asking about it, then let's really buckle down with that and try to...
I didn't think mutual aid was called on the bill of fire.
But if you say we need volunteers or better volunteers, let's get to that. Let's definitely do that. Right. I'm all in favor of
doing
that.
Oh, I agree.
Yeah.
So. But like I said, I feel the officers should live in town or 5 miles of town like it's supposed to be.
Okay. Mr. Mayor. One thing. We're at the five-minute mark at this point, Doug.
Just
I'm sorry.
Just to clarify something, please.
Sure, go ahead.
When you say supposed to be, is that in writing?
Pardon me?
Is that in writing? Is that a written rule?
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I'm
saying. Yeah, it is. Yeah, it is.
Okay.
But there's been positions made up, like training captain and all that, that don't have to live in the city.
Okay.
Why are those positions made up? They should all have to live 5 miles in the city.
That's what the book says, absolutely.
That's right. And I got another question. Mr. Lowry made a comment.
Doug, if you could, maybe five
this last one.
Real quick, please.
Okay. You made a comment that how can a person sleep causing the fire department to spend $10,000?
Didn't think I said...
you did.
No, I said the city. Cost the city $10,000.
Well, it cost the fire department.
Okay. No, it's a little bit different.
And then, what about Twin Creeks?
What about Twin Creeks?
We got $1 million going out there.
Sure do.
Yeah, what about the roads?
Roads?
Why won't we just tear them up and drive on gravel roads?
I didn't tear up the roads and I didn't think...
Hey,
that's right, but how do you do it?
We're not here to argue. Question. We're not here to argue back and forth.
I'm not here to argue.
This is an
I'm telling you a fact.
Thing, okay? Your 5 minutes are up, sir. Okay?
Well, I have no problem making the question.
One more time. That's
okay.
It.
Okay.
As far as Twin Creeks.
Yeah.
I sat on this council when that was brought up through the city.
Mm-hmm.
I personally, along with other council members, they... I mean, for people to show up at the city building, at the meetings, for direction and what they wanted to do, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe two showed up, that would be.
Okay.
I still stand by the decision.
Did you read this letter in the paper?
I didn't make a man shoot himself and kill himself. I have nothing to do with it.
Well, all I know is we might as well just drive on gravel roads.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Who else would like to speak? Name and address, please.
Council, my name's Ron Grout, live at 310 North Henry. I know just about every one of you. Lifelong resident of the city. I've remained very silent throughout the last few months of unrest with the fire division. You do have a problem. You have a very serious problem. I'm not here to challenge you. I'm here to bring a few things to your attention and let you think about it. You take it back. See if I'm right, see if I'm wrong. Doug was trying to articulate a few things. What happened to the volunteers? If you're not welcome, you don't stay. If you're not part of a clique that's been created down there, you leave. Why is it important that the fire officers live within the city? We created a codified ordinance when I was in control of this fire division to ensure that no officer lived further than 5 miles away from this division for a very specific reason. Them officers need to be on scene during the fires and assisting in putting those fires out and making sure our personnel don't get hurt. We've got them living in Quincy, DeGraff, Troy, and it seems like it's okay. I realize you guys may not be familiar with that. That's why I think the clarification needs to be made. A few other things are going on within the division, and it may not be Chief Phillips' fault, and it may not be a problem at all, but I think it is. There were changes back in 12 and 13 with federal laws, changes in minimum wage, definition of part-time versus full-time. Requirements of an employer was different for 25 or less or 50 or more. City of New Carlisle employs greater than 50 employees. Under that provision, if you work greater than 30 hours per week, there are some additional benefits that must be offered. Mr. Phillips made $50,000 last year. I don't think he did it in less than 30 hours per week. There's three others that were right at the 30,000 mark. Between four people, $120,000. Chances are, each one of them were over 30 hours a week. If I am correct, they're living under the assumption, the 7K exemption that I introduced to the city when I was fire chief. While that exemption is still in place, it was an oversight at the federal level, and it doesn't provide you the exit or the excuse that the only thing the 7K provision did was exempted us from overtime. It had nothing to do with the health care. And when they did introduce it, it was something that was an oversight of the Obama administration, and to this date has not been corrected. Many of the local fire divisions that employ part-time employees have limited their hours strictly to 30 hours, no more whatsoever, because they can't afford the health care. We may very well be on the line to pay for that health care, and we may very well be on the line to pay for perhaps as many as four people at $20,000 each, up to $20,000 each, penalty for non-compliance. I ask you to look into it. If I'm wrong, great, I hope I am. If not, we've got a bigger problem. Again, the 7K exemption does still exist, but it was an oversight. They've already admitted that. With regards to the fire, it was a very small fire. I still have a scanner in my garage. I was working in my garage. It went out, and it went out smoke filling in a structure with an elderly bedridden man inside. I knew the family. We lived three houses down. I screamed in the door. My wife, my mother-in-law, and myself ran down to the house. I asked them to start attending to the elderly gentleman while I took care of the fire. Put the fire out, put the item out in the driveway, opened windows, opened doors, went back in to assist my wife and mother-in-law with the elderly gentleman. Then the fire department. Their battalion officer that came in, I started providing him with a quick assessment. He looked at me and stated abruptly, fire division is taking this over. Please leave the residence. Not thank you. Please leave the residence. Oddly enough, shortly after this occurred, Chief Phillips put something on Facebook that inferenced that they have Ohio law behind them. Fire chief is unseen and impeding or interfering with the fire is in violation of law. I did this for 30 years. I'm still a firefighter. I'm still a paramedic. I never interfered with anything. It's this type of conduct that is not healthy for this community. If you want to rebuild this division, it has to start at the top. And when he can play cowboy and do whatever he wants and be not only supported but commended by the city manager, folks, we got a problem. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your help. We appreciate it.
Mr. Grau.
Sure.
I want to thank you for what you did for that senior citizen. And I don't think that the city should be, if that would be the case, if Chief Phillips wanted to press charge, I think that we should stop that immediately, especially if that was on his Facebook, which I'm sure you could prove.
Yes.
Is there any way I can get a copy of that?
Because I'm actually blocked on his side, so.
Okay. Yeah. If you give me a copy of that, because I don't think we should be pressing charges against any fire chief or anyone saving anyone's life.
Mr. Grout, your statements that you had just given us and so forth about possible violations on that, is there a way that you could give that to the city manager and copy us,
all of us?
If you would, please, we'd appreciate that.
Okay? Yeah,
thank you for comments. Thank you for being here. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Who else would like to speak? Go ahead, sir.
Dale Grimm, 114 South Main Street, and I am one of the owners of the New Carlisle News. Our job is to let the community know what's going on. What's going on in their community, what's going on with their city government. Our job also is to keep everyone behind that table accountable to those who have put them in office and those who pay their salary. The way we do that is by requesting information. We do not write stories based on guesswork. We do not write stories based on assumptions. We write stories based on facts. And I am responding to a page in the agenda here in which Mr. Bridge said that he had replied to our request for a copy of the report from the investigators slash consultants. He said he responded three times, but each time it was interlaced with commentary from the city. I am not comfortable trying to extrapolate what is from the city and what is from the law firm. I would like to get a copy of the report from Bennett and Kramer without any commentary from the city so that we can do our job. Also, and correct me if I'm wrong, Andy, we have never heard from Chief Phillips to put anything in the paper about needing volunteers. If he comes see us, I'm sure Andy will sit down with him, make up a nice little graphic. The fire department needs volunteers at no charge to the city. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your comments. We will be discussing that with the city manager to see if we could get you a copy of the original back to him. We will definitely do that. Thank you for your comments. Anyone else? Anyone like to speak? Okay. We do have one.
Mayor Lindsay, 314 North Henry Street. I live next door to 301 Villa where that little fire was yesterday or Saturday. I know them personally. They were both very upset at the way things was said and done to Mr. Grout. They wouldn't say anything at the time. They did mention it to me. They was very grateful for him coming in, doing what he did to get the smoke out of the house, to get the fire put out, which was in the microwave. She was cooking a hamburger, I guess, and thought she wanted it well done or something. But, it would be a sad day in this town if somebody dies in a fire. And I can only imagine the lawsuits this city will have if somebody dies in a fire due to the lack of personnel showing up on a fire. I mean, you know, I'm not the smartest guy in the world. I am a retired firefighter. I know a little bit about what I'm talking about. The problem I see is people in this town don't want to listen to anybody except for one person. That's got to stop, guys. You got to listen to this town. You got to listen to the people. You have to listen to people on the fire department. And I'm even going to go as far as say if the sheriff's department had a problem and they came to you, you need to listen to that too. Second thing I have, back on the police department, with the levy for the police department that was passed in May, why isn't some of that funds available to purchase these cameras that they so desperately need in those cars? I actually thought they had cameras in the cars. Obviously, I was looking at a radar unit or something.
Mr. McIntyre would like to.
That was one of the things that, using the levy money to purchase the cameras, yeah, that's definitely one of the things that we wanted to do or could possibly do. The money's still coming in for that. My thinking was is that although we can use this money for it, maybe we can also look for grants too. I mean, if you have $5 to buy something, but you can get a coupon for 20% off, might as well bring the coupon.
So also get grants.
But yeah, definitely, we could use it for that. That would be a perfect fit for how we could use that money. So that's something we can look into.
I mean, I don't know how long it takes to get a grant or something. I've never written one. I know people that have, but I don't know how long it takes to get one.
It can be anywhere from a year to a couple months. It depends on the grant.
Personally, I think a year for a grant waiting on cameras for the safety of our police officers in this town is not acceptable. A couple of months, maybe. But I mean, you know, you guys and Sergeant Underwood or somebody above him would have to, you know, make that decision. You know, the body cams, I'm glad to see they're coming. There's so much going on in this country right now with cops getting killed just because of a uniform and a badge. You know, the whole country's gone nuts, in my opinion.
Yeah. Sergeant, Mr. Lindsay, I would like our financial director to let you know on how the money is coming in or hasn't come in at this point. We just started collecting by, I believe.
Exactly, and we're very appreciative that this levy did pass. It did take an effect on July 1st. So it's an earned income, so people have to earn it and then report it, and then we collect it, and then we can see what type of funds will be available. We're actually not anticipating enough coming in to report till the first quarter, or the first quarter that we collect, which will be third quarter in the year. So we're hoping to have some available before the end of the year. Otherwise, we are still on our very tight 2015 budget, which it was not in there. But next year, as it continues to come in, and we'll have other appropriations to look at on how that can be spent.
And I understand all that. I also understand the money, the budget's pretty well set now for this year. But if there is any way possible to get a camera in these cars, I think that should be real high on the list, above basically anything else in the city, because it involves lives. And it's not our lives. I mean, we don't have to worry about it because we're not cops. But I hate to read this man's obit in the, or any of his officers, read their obit in New Carlisle News, because somebody killed him and they said, well, the cop did this, and there's no proof that the cop didn't do that. Just my opinion. You gentlemen do, you know, you're all in charge up there. You got to make them decisions along with whoever else needs to be involved in that.
Thank you, Mr. Lindsay. Appreciate it. Anyone else, please? Would you like to speak? Go ahead and up the podium.
Nancy Levanovich, 505P. And I was wondering, I heard some towns being mentioned, the volunteers being from very far away. The only one I remember was DeGraff. I don't know how far away that is, but I'm sure there's fire departments in between here and there that they could volunteer to. So I'm wondering why they are coming here. If they're volunteers, they're not getting any benefits, right? No benefits, nothing. No
I don't believe the people that are living that far away are actually volunteers. I think they're probably on payroll. Is that correct? Is that what I'm hearing? Everyone's payroll, even volunteers.
I mean, like I said, you got a house fire down. They're correct. They're on the part-time program. Yeah.
Okay, if something is written down that it's a 5-mile limit, then that needs to be looked at. I agree with you totally on that. But that, we will be looking into that as far as that situation.
So they're not volunteers, they're being paid.
Yes.
Do they get mileage too?
Thank you. Appreciate it. Anyone else like to speak? Okay, we will finish up with that then. Thank you again for all the input. We appreciate it. We will be getting with the city manager and addressing some of those concerns, to say the least. We had a report done, an investigation done. We looked at that investigation. The investigation said everything was good. We're not hearing that at this point. So consequently, we're going to have to talk with our city manager and see what we can come up with and take a look at it again at this point.
Mr. Mayor.
Thank you for your input. Yes, Mr. Reynolds. One second. Mr. Reynolds, go ahead.
You had mentioned in the Springfield newspaper that if we, or Mr. Bridges said, and you agreed, that if we as a council asked for a more comprehensive report, we would do that. Is that okay if we do that? Because, I mean, I'm sure we all read the report, but issues have been addressed.
Well, when you would like to?
I want detail.
You wanted the detail.
Oh, yeah. I want which ones were true, which ones were false, because they said in that report that some of them were true, but that we didn't know which ones were what.
I think that's what the New Carlisle News asked for also. So we'll see what we can come up with. That.
All right. Okay. I'll keep asking.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. What?
A question. Could you guys please look into that before anybody gets killed?
We definitely would want to do that. We want the safety. We want the safety of the citizens of New Carlisle. That's the reason that we agreed to do what we did. Okay, so we will definitely continue this at this point.
One more. Well, okay. Vance Boyd.
Please go. Please go to the microphone so I can pick you up.
Mike Vance Boyd is on a fire run. He's at a wedding. One of our officers got married. He sat there and drank all night. I did not drink because I had to go back and work battalion. I got up at midnight, Diane came in, and when I got, and Vance Coit come into the firehouse, and I told Diane, he is not to run. Well, we had an alarm go out, smoke detector. I went from my house to the scene. I asked Diane, I said, did he get on the engine? She said she didn't know because she had left early. Well, they pull up with the Quint, and guess who's on there? He had been drinking all night.
What is his rank?
Lieutenant.
He's a lieutenant, you're a captain.
Yes. Why did he not get dropped back down to firefighter or fired?
Mr. Lowry, yes.
Yes.
Did you at that time or within say 48 hours or whatever file a report?
Yes, I did. Called my assistant chief.
Hang on, what did you do with it? Did you give it to
Rick Ritter?
Someone in the city, or did you give it
Rick Ritter?
Pardon?
I gave it Rick Ritter.
Who lives 10 miles out of the city, right?
Huh?
Who, by the way, lives 10 miles out of the city?
No, he does not live 10 miles out of the city. He lives 5 miles out of the city. He's within the limits. But I called him the next day. And I told him, he went to Bragg. They gave him 2 week suspension. What would you do if a fireman, a lieutenant, showed up in your house that smelled like alcohol?
Okay, I have another question. Do you have a disciplinary procedure that you have to do?
Well,
I mean, for certain offenses, you can't just put the guy and check your file. Do you have a disciplinary procedure, and what is that procedure to follow, is what I'm asking.
Okay, the person who talked to him is the EMS captain. Why she talked to him, I don't know. They have a position that, but that's not the point. You do not let a guy get on fire truck drunk.
I agree with you. What I'm asking but, was, is there a procedure?
Yes, there is. Yes.
And was it
and they, no. Well, they talked to him, gave him two weeks suspension.
Okay, and was that in line with the procedure is what I'm asking?
Yeah. But that's not the point.
Yes.
It is the point.
It is the point. If that's in writing, that that's...
He was drunk.
I understand what you're saying, sir.
Huh? He has been a firefighter for 2 years. Every run we have been on, I have been there. I took over. I had to take over because he didn't know how to do it.
Okay, we need to stop at this point.
We
understand what you said, and we appreciate all the input that we're getting. We're going to check that. We have one more person like to speak. We were closing it out real quick, please.
My name is Laura McDowell, and I live at 606 Walsh. I was just wondering on that incident. I have a family member that was once killed in a drunk driving incident. I think no personnel, I don't care what the procedure is, I don't care if they followed it through and through. If anybody that's supposed to protect our citizens is drinking and then getting on a run, whether it be an officer, whether it be a councilman, whether it be a manager, whether it be a firefighter, that does not need to follow a procedure. There needs to be a new rule about that. No drugs, alcohol involved. I mean, that's plain and simple, right?
I agree with you.
And I agree with you. I just wondered, was there a procedure you have to go through?
Right. But if there is, there needs to be something labeled to where if somebody knows that somebody showed up and they've been drinking, whether they're drunk or not, if they have consumed alcohol, 2 week suspension,
a terminable offense.
It should be at least a suspension or you're gone. We don't want you protecting our city if you're drinking and then take the chance of going out and killing someone else to try and save someone else. That makes no sense whatsoever.
I agree.
No sense.
We agree with you. Thank you for your input. We appreciate it.
Laura. What was your last name again?
McDowell.
M-C-D-O-W-E-L-L.
Would you go up to the podium, please, if you're going to speak, so he can identify you? Thank you.
One more with the fire department. I was going to say on the policies, I believe there is in their disciplinary action, and there's a different level. Without looking at it, I can't tell you.
Right, and
but,
that's what I'm
but there, there is infraction levels, and I don't know off the top of my head, but possibly that would be one that's most severe, and it could be termination immediate. But yes, you're right. There is a verbal warning, written warning type thing.
And that's what I was getting at, in my opinion. I can't state what the policy is. In my opinion, if you show up drunk, you should be dismissed immediately. Okay? And that's what I was trying to get at, if that's in there.
Yeah, I'm just trying to clarify that for you. I believe that is in there.
Okay. Thank you for your input. We appreciate it. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
To the firefighters are here tonight, most of Doug and and Ward for being back. You know, we said it, or at least some of us said it last time. Thank you for coming tonight. I mean, because, you know, leading up to this, we only heard from one side. Now, I'm not saying that one side's wrong or one side's right, but all we had to go off was, one, the report, and two, from what we were being told at previous council meetings. So, you know, regardless of what may come of all this or what he thinks or what he thinks or what you think, it's communication is key. So thank you for coming. It's a positive either way.
I just hope you guys look right.
In relation to that, you're right. You do see the same faces, or you did. There's different faces here tonight, but you did see the same people over again. That's because they're the people in that clique. Now, the ones that you haven't seen and you're probably not going to are the ones that don't agree with it, who are afraid to say something for retaliation. And even the city manager that last meeting said they're weeding out those people. So why would you get up and speak against something now you have the fear of being retaliated against, whether you get dismissed, your hours are cut? That's why you're not seeing those other people. Just because they're not here doesn't mean they don't have something to say. They're afraid to say it.
Okay, thank you.
Well, I have something to say in relation to that, okay? I understand what you're saying, but what bothers me most is that there was a letter that came about, okay? And there was a group of people who were pro the fire department, everything's fine, okay? Now, I'm not blaming anybody, but I can tell you that if I was on the fire department, and I'm just going to pick out one instance, okay, and saw somebody on a fire truck or show up and seen drunk, I'll take my chance. If you want to fire me, but I'm going to be in front of city council complaining about it. Say, wait a minute, this did happen. And I think this should have been brought out 4 weeks ago, okay? If you're afraid of retaliation, you know, so be it. Something like that, you don't hold it back and say I'm worried about it.
Absolutely agree, 100%.
Because that's absolutely horrible.
Now you,
if it happened, and I don't know if it's not on you or I or you or anybody else.
I don't know.
We've heard a ton of stuff over the last 4 weeks. But if that happened, that man should have been dismissed within 24 hours after there was a short investigation to find out what happened. And if they found out what happened, then he should have been gone.
Well, here's the problem.
And this should have been come out before all this investigation stuff, guys, is what I'm saying. You know, we had another faction here saying, hey, everything's good, none of this stuff happens, it's just people that don't want to work. And you answered the question last time, the guy said you've had 70 opportunities to come to work and only showed up 20. And you didn't answer.
No, you know what? That number is not actually fact because
and that's
the
time you should have spoke up and said so. Okay.
Well, I had to look at that.
I'm not picking on you, but I'm just saying, you know, I'm with you guys. That's really going
to
win, do something about it. Okay?
What they counted.
Okay, we need to stop here now on this.
No,
here's what I'm going to ask.
Okay? Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
I'm going to ask for council to do a work session with the city manager. We're going to discuss this. We're going to have a work session, discuss everything that we've heard tonight, and we're going to try and resolve what's going on. I think that's warranted. We do need to have a work session to be able to try and resolve it. We've heard a lot of different things this evening that we had not heard previously, okay? So we will definitely do that. We're gonna set a work session if we can see when a Monday night's open. But for tonight, we need to put it to bed at this time. Let us have a work session. Let us discuss this. We've heard from everybody. I'm sorry?
Those are public too, right?
It'll be public. If you'd like to appear to that, that'd be fine.
Please,
but we need to have a work session. So that way you guys can come if you wish, voice your concerns, and we do have concerns. We can understand that.
Okay. I think it's a great idea. I just hope that Mr. Bridge doesn't act like he did at the last meeting, because that's
Mr. Bridge
inappropriate.
Works for us, and we will be discussing that with him, okay? Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
I just think that maybe they were waiting to see what the report said.
Okay. Thank you again. Could we see when the next Monday is available for us, or what will be available here to be able to do? Do we have a calendar available? Who has a calendar?
Mayor, can I make a suggestion?
Yes, sir.
That we wait till we get input from Mr. Bridge, because it may be he may not be available for that meeting, so we want to.
Well, we can set a tentative. We'll set a tentative at this point. We would like to have a work session for that. So what do we have on Mondays coming up?
We have the 10th. And then we have the 24th.
24th is after the next council meeting,
yes.
Correct?
Right.
Does that work for everybody, the 24th?
I can't make the 10th work.
The 24th will work?
I'm going to be out of town. Just the 24th can make it work.
You can't make the 24th?
I can't.
Cannot?
Can.
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 You are able to do that.
The 24th is good.
Huh? Okay, gotcha. Everybody can make the 24th.
Yes.
Is that correct? Could we set a tentative date of the 24th? 6:30 work for everybody?
Yep.
6:30 here at the Shelter House, and we're going to be discussing the fire department again. The public is invited. Please, if you'd like to come and voice concerns again, we need to hear them.
Mr. Yes, Mayor, I would like to make a suggestion.
Yes, sir.
That the two people that conducted the investigation be at that point.
That's going to cost us money at that point. I think what we need is...
I don't have it in front of me, but they said they would be available.
Okay, we'll check on that.
Questions and answers at no cost.
We'll check on that.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
I'd like to make a motion for a work session on the 24th at 6:30 here at the Shelter House to discuss the fire department.
Second.
Choose.
Give me a second here.
Choose for anyone. But to let everybody know out there, we're definitely concerned. There's no doubt about it. We're glad that you've shown up and you've talked with us on this. We were given a report, as you well know. The report said that everything is copacetic in the fire department. We're definitely going to look into it further now. It doesn't mean that we can investigate it. We're not a body that is an investigating body in that respect. But we will find out and see what we come up with. I understand. I remember that was in that letter. So bear with us. Okay. Are you ready, Mr. Collier, to call for the vote?
Yes. Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Craybach?
Yes.
Mr. Mike Lowry?
Yes.
Mayor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Zambach?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Passed 7-0. For August 24th at 6:30 p.m. here at Smith Park Shelter House.
Thank you, sir. All right, let's go on now, please. Committee reports not tonight, is that correct? I'm sorry, yes, sir.
Just one afterthought. Are you absolutely sure that the 24th is not the joint government meeting? Because we were discussing this before the meeting and we're taking this one.
I thought the 31st.
The 31st.
I think
the 31st.
Thank you for bringing that up.
Excuse me, is anybody disabled? Did anybody write down what date they established for the next joint government work session?
The 23rd at 6:30.
23rd
of... sorry, not 23rd. My bad. Sorry, I'm clicking on it right now. I have my phone here.
Joint meeting is
the joint meeting is the 31st, sorry.
Of August.
31st of August.
Okay, all right. Good, thank you.
Thank you for that. Okay, that's been passed.
Everything's my
phone. 7-0. We'll talk to the city manager on it. All right, we'll go forward now. The committee reports, there's none tonight. Resolutions. We have a resolution tonight. If you'd like to read that when you're ready, sir.
Resolution 15-04-04R, public hearing in action tonight. A resolution declaring the necessity of improving the streets of the city of New Carlisle, Ohio by lighting them.
Council.
So moved.
Second.
I had a motion by Mr. Zambach, correct?
Correct.
Second by Mr. Reynolds.
Correct. This is essentially housekeeping, is it not? Something we do every year to, do you mind explaining what it does?
I'll forward that on for the, I'm getting something for Randy real quick.
No, gotcha.
It's basically every year we have to do the resolution to get the street lightings on, and then we'll have ordinances to establish the rate and to the verbiage of how would we do that.
Yeah, I see the next meeting there's a number of items on street lighting, so great, thank you.
It's basically housekeeping.
I will share that I've been around 24 years and we have done this every year.
Sure.
Any other questions, anyone?
Yes.
Okay, would you go ahead and call for the vote, please?
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Craybach?
Yes.
Mr. Mike Lowry?
Yes.
Mayor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Zambach?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Pass 7-0.
Thank you. Now, if you go ahead and read the ordinances that are going to be for action next council meeting.
Yes. So so bear with me. There are five.
Sure, take your time. You're ready. Go ahead.
Ordinance 15-31, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on H-17-15. Oh, sorry, there's a typo error there on the agenda. That is 15.
Sure is.
Every one of them. Yes, Mr. Bridge did that, so I'll pass that on. Ordinance 15-31, an ordinance determining to proceed with the improvement of certain public streets within the corporate limits of the city of New Carlisle, Ohio, by lighting them. Ordinance 15-32, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on H-17-15. An ordinance levying assessments for the improvement of certain public streets within the corporate limits of the city of New Carlisle, Ohio, by lighting them. Ordinance 15-33, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on H-17-15. An ordinance certifying to the Clark County Auditor and authorizing placement on the tax duplicate certain delinquent utility accounts for collection with real estate taxes. Ordinance 15-34, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on H-17-15. An ordinance certifying to the Clark County Auditor and authorizing placement on the tax duplicate certain uncollected weed and or grass cutting fees for collection with real estate taxes. Ordinance 15-35, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on H-17-15. An ordinance certifying to the Clark County Auditor and authorizing placement on the tax duplicate certain uncollected nuisance abatement fees for collection with real estate taxes.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Other business? Council, other business? Mr. Collier, would you read about the National Night Out, please?
Farmers Market will continue on Saturday mornings from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. in the downtown area. The Crime Watch Committee, there'll be a meeting this Wednesday, August the 12th at 6:30 p.m. here at Smith Park Shelter House. National Night Out will occur tomorrow night, Tuesday, August the 4th at 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. in the IGA parking lot. And there'll be a joint government meeting August 31st at Tecumseh High School. Is that correct? It is their turn.
I believe it's Tecumseh. Yes.
At Tecumseh High School, and that starts at 6:30 p.m. And that meeting is also open to the public.
Correct. Anything else? Yep. Council, anything? Council, anyone? You already lost your place.
Okay.
Well, go ahead. What would you like?
Recently, I've been doing a lot of walking around town, and I see people remodeling their houses, and that's all good, and try to take care of the yard. But however, there's another segment that I also see people throwing trash and stuff out the windows, especially around the old CVS building along Main Street there. You know, I go up and get ice cream from Arab Queen. The other night, my wife and I just happened to find a plastic bag, and we start picking up trash while we're walking. You know, we filled it up by the time we got to Arab Queen and threw that in. You know, so I see a lot of trash. And, you know, the studies have shown that people are proud of their towns. They'll take care of their towns, and and they won't throw trash out in their towns because they feel that this is where I live. I don't know if it's just people going through town or just, you know, whatever, but I'm going to say this, you know, pick up a plastic bag and pick up the trash, even though somebody else throws it or not, you know, even though, it's your responsibility too because you live here, you know, it's your house, it's your home. Crop Walk is coming in September, is it? Crop, what is it?
Towards the end of
September. September Crop Walk. You know, if you don't know what it is, it started with the Heifer Project at one point. Crop Walk is that, you know, you walk a certain distance and you get money donations for that. The New Carlisle Church of the Brethren, you know, is really into that. And Bethel Church is United. And so, you know, if you contact anybody there. Well, I'm going to save it. But that is, grab a hold of a plastic bag, pick up the trash as you're walking along in the Crop Walk. And at the end, Carlisle Church of the Brethren has a nice big dumpster. I would love to see that.
Thank you, John. Appreciate it. Anybody else? Anything? Pardon? Yes.
Real quick, something that came up today is I found out there are no trash bags being sold at any of the Speedways Marathon anywhere in town. So we contacted Waste Management today to try and find out how we could get this at least partially resolved. We're going to try, I think Ms. Harris said we can try to do at least on a temporary basis, is work with them to get the bags at the city building and sell them through the city building. And I don't know how long that'll be, you know, until maybe they can get a contract with someone. The problem is you'll be only able to get bags Monday through Friday from 8 to 5, instead if you run out of bags on a Saturday or Sunday like you used to be able to do, is get them from Speedway. That's no longer, but supposedly they're working on some agreement that they had with Speedway. We'll try and get the bags out as fast as we can, at least sell them at the city building temporarily.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Howie, when will they be doing that at the city building? Do you have a date yet? Start date?
Just made the call to their rep like this afternoon. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Anyone else, council? Mr. Zambo.
I move we adjourn.
I agree with you.